like to thank you for picking up this video on how to catch albacore. In this video, you're going to learn the basics that you need to know before you go on that first albacore trip. Or we're going to start out with some footage aboard the American Angler and then show you a little bit more that was shot on the Indian. Well, let's get started and show you some exciting action on albacore fishing. Well, we're on a 3-day trip aboard the American Angler. First stop of the day, and it is wide open. We're about 100 miles from San Diego, up in between the Cortez and Tanner Bay, and there are fish everywhere. I got this nice albacore coming up here. Got him deep color. There he is, deep color. Gancho! Ooh, nice big albacore. Don't pull.
I'll pull your line.
One more time. All right, Rick, thanks.
Woo!
This is a beautiful albacore you just got it. Cook Rick just gaffed it for me. Beautiful fish. For this video, we wanted to ensure some good quality fishing and lots of great knowledge that would help you for your very first albacore fishing trip. And for those of you that have been fishing before, we wanted to give you some tips and information to help you catch some more bigger fish and be more successful on your next albacore adventure. Well, the boat we decided for this trip is American Angler. We'll be filming the first part of our series on this boat, and then we'll be going aboard the Indian. The American Angler operates out of Point Loma Sport Fishing here in San Diego. It offers everything from 2 to 18 day trips, and for this first part of our how-to tape, we'll be on a 3-day trip aboard the American Angler looking for albacore. With everyone safely on board and all the new supplies safely stored away, the sport fisher slowly moves over to the bait receiver, where the crew will take their time to fill up all the boat's bait tanks with a good supply of anchovies and live sardines. When you're fishing for albacore and any sort of tuna, having a good supply of live bait is very, very important. Here the crew will take their time to slowly bring the fish out of the bait receivers and put them into the boat's bait tank. You can't rush this process. If you do, all you're going to do is kill the bait. So notice how slow and careful the crew works as a one giant team to ensure a good supply of quality bait for its anglers. As the crew finishes up filling up the last bait tanks with live bait, let's slide into the galley and listen what our skipper, Jim, has to tell us about what's coming up on our 3-day adventure.
And you cast out your bait, all right? And it lands right here, and the natural defense of a sardine or an anchovy is to swim in a darting motion. You never really sit there and watch them. Sardines usually, they take off, but they also dart around a little bit, especially anchovies more. So I cast my bait out, landed here, went over here, and it ended up right there, and I just got a bite by that, right where that is. I feel that bite. Well, if I set the hook right now, let it slack off for a second, I'm never gonna get it tight. Okay? A good hook setting technique is, once you feel the bite, you put it in gear and you wait for the fish to take all the slack out until you got a little bit of a pull, the pressure pulls down a little bit on the rod tip. Okay? Or a lot of times these bluefin albacore, what happens, you always see those guys that the albacore come up with two hooks in their mouth. Well, what happens is that the albacore or the tuna will come up and they'll eat a bait, and they're coming back to the boat to eat another one, and the other guy doesn't even know he's bit. If you don't feel your bait, you should always be in contact with your bait. You should always be feeling it. You should be thumbing your spool a little bit, feeling that bait, okay? Or once you feel that, like a steady thump, you know, and you don't feel any slack, you don't feel your line getting tight, just keep reeling until the line gets tight. Now the line gets tight, you got a little downward pressure on the pole. Now you know you got a straight line from the rod tip down to the hook to the fish's mouth. That's where you're gonna get a good hook set, okay? Now before all that happens, check your drag before you cast. All right? Make sure you got a good drag. It's better to have a little looser drag from the get-go, because if it takes some of your line away, that's fine. You can always get it back. But if you got the drag so tight that you set the hook on that fish and it busts off, that fish is gone. It's not going to come back. Okay? So always check your drag prior to casting. It should be about 20% of the line test. I just do it by hand. So if this is 40-pound test here, it's caught. I can feel the line coming off, but I know I'll get a good hook set. This is 40-pound test, and you want to match the hook size with the line, okay? This is a 5-0 hook, Gamagatsu hook, and if you go heavier line, I'd say 50 and 60-pound, we got some great bait back there. If you fish heavier line, you could go ahead and use a 5-0 or 6-0 hook. And on the, we got some anchovies. I doubt if anybody's going to want to fish with those, but we fish with those for 20, 25. We probably got that more for chumming for the albacore. All right. And a 30 to 40 pound 4-0, 5-0 hook. You can get away with a 3-0. We have some really nice bait. Like I said, 5-0s and 6-0 hooks for the 40, 50, and 60 pound. And if you got bigger hooks, with their biting, go for it. On the 1680, you get away with 6-0s and 8-0s, okay? A little jig and a hook safety deal, I like to say. I don't see anybody out there who's, there is one right there. He's got a hook that's up high and we're walking and rolling and people are running up and down the rail. If you got a hook on your guide right here or a jig and somebody is walking around, you might want to be a little careful because they could catch it in their arm, all right? Good hook safety, the best thing to do, even on your treble hook jigs or anything like that, or your feathers for trolling, just put it right behind the reel when you put it back in the rack in there, and nobody will get their legs caught in it. It's a lot safer for everybody. Okay? Any questions on anything yet so far?
Go around the line. Go around the side. make some new friends.
A lot of times when things are hectic, it happened last year, but it's pretty funny. There's a gentleman fishing at the side. We had a really good bite going on, and all this clutter in the back. And he had this, he's about this far away, and he had about this much tangle. You know, I mean, this much angle going. Well, what are you doing? He goes, I'm fishing. Well, that's good. You see that angle? He goes, I don't want to go back there. There's too much trouble going on back there. Well, he had a Pen 4-0 or so with 40 pound on it. About all his line was gone. So in this little bit of distance, I already got 2 feet of angle. He's got 200 yards out. How much angle do you think he had? He was back there. I was wondering why there was a couple of fish that wouldn't come apart. He was causing a little bit of the problems. So once we got, I explained to him more about how to keep no angle, we got him untangled, everybody got their fish, and it was a good thing. So always stay on top of your fish. You got that much angle, stay like this. This is the rail, right here. Stay 90 degrees to your fish. This isn't 90 degrees. A lot of people think, you know, they turn their body a little bit. I'm in front of my fish. Okay, I'll stay right in front of it, 90 degree angle, okay? And fish goes to the left, go to the right, go, you know, follow it around. What happens a lot of times on these big fish, anything over 30, 40 pounds, a tuna does that tuna circle, okay, either to the left or to the right. And when you have deep color, that's where the crew member is going to tell you either to stand your place or follow your fish. If you have too much going on, we'll have you fall around. Because if you followed every one of those circles, you just do circles around the boat. Okay? So what you want to do, if you have it at deep color, and let's say the fish is going around to the left, you want to pull the opposite direction. Back off the drag a little bit. You want to pull the opposite direction. You want to pull to the left. That'll bring the fish into a circle. Once it starts coming back right at you, that's when you're going to reel down and get your line back. Okay? Now the fish is going to go the opposite direction. It's going to start heading away from you. Keep the rod taut, boat up, and pull them around the opposite direction. Keep them coming around like this. Bring that fish into a circle. Once he gets back into right in front of you, that's when you're going to reel down and get some line again. Okay? When he's coming back at you, you're going to pull the opposite direction when he's coming around that circle. And you keep doing that on the tail beats of the fish. You'll see the head beat on your rod. That's the actual tail beat. If you keep that pressure on it, you'll get your fish a lot quicker. All right? You got your pole bowed up, and you're ready to go, and that fish wants to run. You're lifting that fish with this part of the fishing pole. That's where they're designed. The tip is just mainly for casting your bait and everything. You're lifting your fishing pole from about 3 feet on back. So if they're sitting there fishing in your fish pole, you don't want to keep lifting your rod up above your head like this, because all you're doing is just bending the tip right here. You're not lifting the fish anymore. Okay, so always keep your rod down. Once we got it in a deep color, keep the rod tip down and only pull up to about 11 o'clock, about that high. Keep the pole down. And as you see the tail be going, you'll see the tail be going. And once it'll slack up on you real quick, wind down and get some. Okay? What happens a lot of times too on these bigger fish, or even on a smaller fish, everybody thinks, well, I'm going to help these guys out because they're helping me, I want to help them. I'm going to back up from the rail, and they're going to gap my fish. That kind of does the opposite for us. It cuts off your view of the fish because then you're not going to be able to see what's going on, and it cuts the angle down. Now your fish has a better chance of running underneath the boat and sawing you off. Okay? So always stay up against the rail, right there. Stay up against the rail. This way, if it runs underneath the boat, you can set your rod tip down, and it won't rub on the boat, and you can see what's going on. When you're pulling on your fish, keep pulling it until it comes right at you, and lay the fish out for the crew member to gap your fish. Once they gap your fish, good practices. Sometimes, you know, things happen. We miss. Or we gaff them, they light up, and they rip out of the gaff. Okay? Good practice. Once that crew member gaffs your fish, take it out of gear, keep your thumb on the spool, or what I do is I take it out of gear and I put the clicker on. If that fish falls off the gaff, it's going to keep running. It'll just fall off, your line goes out, and you start your battle all over again. If you have it in gear, and you're all anxious about getting that fish falls off the gaff, your line's probably gonna snap and you're not gonna get that fish back. Besides that, it's got a big old hole in it. It's useless now, okay? Any questions on anything? No? Come on.
Wide open, everywhere you look, there's fish going. This is what three-day fishing is all about, multi-day fishing. All kinds of action, everywhere you look. Everybody's on fish. Most of the fish right now are on live bait, but some of the guys are using iron jigs. They get lots of fish too. Fish are coming out of the water. This is wide open. Woo! Take a little break here.
Super caster.
lot of times when these guys are fighting, guys are out fishing, and these albacore come up and eat, come to the boat, and they eat real fast. A lot of times you'll get an albacore that'll eat two baits, like these guys got here. You got a hook in the corner and a deeper hook down deep. The way we do it on the boat is that the deeper hook gets the fish. So I'm going to take this one hook out right here. And who's ever fishes down there without a hook, cut the hook, and I'm going to cut the line on the other one. It's their fish. So let's tangle their line. It's his fish. A lot of times when the albacore are really eager, they come to the boat, someone's got their bait out there, and they eat the anchovy, their sardine, and they come right towards the boat looking for some more bait to eat. A lot of times that first person doesn't feel that bite. Then the second one does, and they sets the hook, and the fish runs off the other way. So it's always a good thing to stay in contact with your bait at all times, and your line, so you know when you got a bite or not. So these guys got to share this fish, but one only gets it. Good job, guys. You guys got a tag there?
Bacon.
How would you like it, whole or filleted?
One more time around. There you go. Nice fish there. Nice.
All right, bacon.
All right. Oh, I gotta catch another one right here. Darn the bad luck again. Oh my! Getting his own.
We came on button. Where is the boat?
Nice fish. Here we go. There's a nice albacore right there. That's what it's all about. Gosh darn it, Dan. You've come a long way from your spinning days.
That's how long Jimmy owned me when I used to only fish spinning rods. All right.
Okay, great job.
Thanks a lot, man. Congratulations. So, this type of fishing that we're doing today, just kind of fishing for the tuna, this is pretty typical for albacore fishing.
Oh yes, considerably. You know, this was another spot of puddlers that were up. We got a jig strike on them. There's a lot of fish that are up right now. You can't see them. They just come up real quick for just a moment. Fish has got to come around here right now. There's been jig strikes.
Thanks.
And on these fish.
Okay, I just cut my line. Like a
that's
war
jig
zone
strikes, right? Yeah, it's a war zone right here. But there's jig strikes and meter marks. There's a little spot of puddlers that we came across that we're trying to get up to. And so it's been a productive day. It's been great.
You see all the fish behind us. Everybody behind us has fish going. Pretty wide open. We're on the American Angler, Jim Bacon, Captain. We go back a long, long time. Today we're having a lot of fun out here fishing.
Remember, Jim Bacon's my nickname.
I want you to give me your real last name.
Jim Slifkoff.
And that way your mom will be happy.
Yeah, my mom will be real happy. Hi, Mom.
And I got in trouble one time. A long time ago, I did an article. I put in a photo of Jim, and I called him Jim Bacon, ran to Westchester News. And he goes, that's not my name. My mom got all mad at me.
Oh, my aunt did. It was that picture of the Western Outdoor News, and it was a nice photo. And my aunt saw it. She goes, what's wrong? Your last name's not good enough for you?
I didn't know that was his nickname.
Okay.
All right,
Jim, I got to get back to work. Thanks a lot, Dan.
Okay, well, we got a lot more action, a lot more fish. It's wide open. This is what wide open is. If you look wide open up in the internet, there'd be a picture of the American Angler with all these rods going right in.
Got a tag?
Yeah. I want to keep that one whole. This is probably my biggest one.
Okay.
Thanks.
Sure.
Just instant. My first, I'm sorry, This is my fifth fish in about
that color right here.
20 minutes. Just unbelievably wide open bite. Moved up to 60 pound on the last two fish.
Did you get bit on the 60, Dan?
Yeah. It's just wide open.
Don't pull on that line.
Who wants the fish?
Okay, coming down. Woo! Coming down the ramp.
Another right. Nice albacore.
This is our captain with us today. This is Jim Bacon. Bacon and I go back many, many years, about 15, 16 years when he was on the blackjack as a deckhand. He got his license over the years, and now he's running long-range boats. That's the first albacore he's ever got for me. Thanks a lot,
oh,
man.
Oh, come on. We caught more than that back years ago.
We caught bluefin tuna. Lots of
bluefin. Lots of bluefin, yeah.
Yeah, I think that's
the front cage.
Yeah.
All right, we got to get back to busy.
Right, thanks, man.
Thank you.
You can cut that.
You see right there, there's a few fish still swimming underneath us. Just talked to one of the other boats. He still hasn't got on a whole bunch of fish yet, but he's still looking around. He's not too far from us, and we got like four or five fish still hanging right now. So I'm gonna sit here and see if any more want to build up underneath us. You know, no use going anywhere and running around for nothing. So we'll stay here as long as we got a few fish going. I don't see much underneath the boat, but as long as we have a few going, we're gonna stay. And once we get going again, we'll have another trolling team up and find some more with the sonar or the fathometer. Or there's been a few polar fish that have been swimming up. This spot was a puddler, and as I came up on it, it had a nice sonar mark right underneath the puddlers. So once I stopped, the fish came right underneath the boat, and that's why we're doing good. Now this is a good stop. We got 45, 50 albacore out of this stop, and there's still a few hanging. Okay, so I'm gonna go back on deck and see what else we got going on.
Got another albacore running here. Fish really ran good. He picked up my bait. And for some reason, he charged the boat. We got a light outfit here, 30-pound test line. Get the Shakespeare Ugly-Stick Tiger Rod. Mule reel. Nice fighter. Really his head shake. He doesn't like the boat. He must have seen the boat. All I'm doing is just trying to slowly lift up and wind down. See a couple more fish over here behind me. We were kind of a lull there. We had a bunch of fish for a couple of stops and then just had a little Peter bite there. All of a sudden, this fish came through. Boy, it's really running good now. The loose line is holding two fish together. Another crew member there is trying to grab the other rod. This just comes with years of experience, what these guys are doing here. This is part of what you pay for.
Put the rods in together, Mike. I don't have a whole lot of rods.
Sure, see that big knot? Big knot right there.
Okay, back up, guys.
Watch what they're doing there, taking out the knots. Basket weaving, as we call it. This comes with experience.
Rocket. Hold on.
Good job.
Got it?
That one liner.
Can you catch a fish?
There you go. Put it in your rock launcher there.
Set him underneath, boys.
Back over the top. There you go. Back around.
Okay, keep going. One more time. Keep coming. Keep coming.
There you go. Keep in front of you. Watch, watch the rest of them. Right? Come back around. Line up. Okay, back around. Okay, walk to your left. Go ahead. Just keep.
There he is. Deep collar. Let's try to keep him up on the surface. Make it a little bit easier for the crew. All you want to do is lay him out. Give him a nice shot. He has a nice shot to gap. Just lay it out like that. One more time. One more turn. Just like that. Perfect head gap. Nice head gap. Beautiful. Thanks a lot. That's what we're trying to catch. Big albacore. Just beautiful head gap like that. Quality fish.
Go ahead and let your baits go, guys. This is a beautiful spot. See that right here? That's all fish right there. That's just absolutely perfect. That's a good spot of fish right there. They're just hanging right off her bow. So let's see what they'll come back and bite. Get some guys back out there fishing. That's really a lot of fish. That's a good amount there. Let's see what we catch here.
If it goes underneath the boat, keep your rod down so it doesn't rub up against the boat. Wind down, keep your rod down, and just pull it out away from the boat. Just pull them out. There you go. Just hold it out. When the fish starts coming around in a circle here, pull the opposite direction and wind down when he comes right at you. You're doing great. Now he's going to come right back at you here. Wind down. Okay, now he's going to come right up the gap. You know, just hold him flat right out. There you go. Now take it out of gear. And every time anybody counts a fish for you, you take it out of gear and you put the clicker on. This way, if the fish falls off the gap, if it falls off the gap, you'll still have your fish and you won't lose it. Okay, great job.
Thank you. How about that one today? Number 11. I got your tag already.
I got it right here at Tex. Thank you very much. You know, that's the biggest thing that a lot of people do is they like to back up from the rail. They think they're helping us when they're fighting a fish. If you stay up against the rail, and that way you can see your fish at all times. If the fish wants to run underneath the boat, all you have to do is drop your rod tip down, and it won't rub up against the boat or get caught in the propellers, and you just pull them out away from the boat. So he did a great job on that fish. So evidently, he listened to my tackle seminar. So that was a great job. Thanks.
So fun, this video. We showed you a lot of action for catching albacore while fishing out here on the American Angler. Well, right now we're gonna take a little break from the action and give you a little bit more how-to hands-on information. Now, you've seen so far, most of the action has been taking place fishing with live bait. And selecting a live bait, putting on a live bait, is very important for albacore fishing. And this is how we would get our bait. This is considered the big tank here. You never want to reach in here for a bait. This is the bait well. This is where we grab our bait. Now here we can look in here, and we have a nice selection of both anchovies and sardines. The bait you want to catch is one of the hardest baits to catch. You want to look for a good bait. Now, a bait like this, that's upside down, floating, would be a bad bait. See, it's missing an eyeball, scales are missing. You would never want to fish this. What you want to do is find a bait that's hard to catch. So, like this one, this is a good one. Nice big sardine. And the way we want to do that is just handle it like this. Use your thumb to control it. And there's a bunch of ways to pin it on. And I'll show you some of my basic ways. Number one way is to go right in front of the eyeball. There's two little nostril holes. Go ahead and just slide it right there. Just like that. This would be my number one way for pinning on the sardine. Here we have a nice selection of anchovies and sardines. Anchovies, if you're gonna use a sinker or you might want to go ahead and hook up this way, go right through the lower jaw and in front of the nose, and it should look just like that. Now keep them nice and lively for a while, and it works good. Now another way that you can hook an anchovy is called collar hooking. And you just bend the head back a little bit right here by the gill plate, and you go in, and you just go right in front of the collar there. and that works good. So if you use this technique, make sure you don't have any sinker on it. Just fly line it. If you're going to use any sinker at all, you want to go ahead and do the first way like I showed you. Front of the jaw, right there. So it's right in front. Again, spend a little bit of time at the bait well. This is the most important place when you're fishing with live bait. You want to spend a few minutes here, look at all the baits, try to see which ones are good shape. And just by looking at the well here, you can tell which one has a nice shiny coat on them, which ones have all their scales, and those are the ones that are going to swim the best. Again, for a sardine, go ahead and grab a nice sardine, take the hook, and run it right in front of the nostrils there. That's the way it should look, just like that. Okay, well, let's get back on the water, the American Angler, show you some more exciting action and how to fish for albacore.
And the best place to cast is right off the stern over here. Right off the stern, so this way, when you start drifting, when the boat's drifting this way, your bait will continue to go away from the boat. So let's get you a bait out in this corner over here, and we'll see what we can do. Always step up against the rail right here when you make your cast. Watch how this gentleman's coming around right here. This way you don't clock him, you get a better cast. Okay? This way now your bait's away from the boat, and the chances of getting a bite are a lot better for yourself. There you go. Good luck. Okay, take it out of gear. Good job. You're on it.
All out of gear.
And another nice albacore right in the head. Yeah. This gentleman here was tangled a few times, and by keeping his cool and not panicking, he was able to get his fish, and we didn't lose the other one. You know, as long as you keep your cool and work with each other and untangle the lines, you know, the chances of losing your fish are pretty slim. So you did a good job. Congratulations.
Thank you.
How would you like your fish?
Whole fish.
Whole fish. Like, let's go get another one.
He'd like it thrown back in, Jim.
Yeah, I started working on the boats when I was 16, 17, heading up in Redondo. Worked there for a few years, a bunch of years, on the City Redondo and the Blackjack. And, you know, the first person I worked for was Neil Jernstrom on the old sharpshooter. Then I worked for his brother for a while. I left sport fishing on, did construction, welding. I'm a certified welder, done a couple of other different things. But it seems like I've always come back to fishing. So for 6 years now, I've made it fully devoted back to fishing. And 2 years ago, Danny Sampson gave me the opportunity to run this boat. I was chief engineer on the Qualifier 105 for all that time. And he gave me the opportunity to run this boat. It's a beautiful boat. We're working good together. He's sure teaching me a lot about running a boat. And I really enjoy it. I like being out with the people. And of course, when it's flat, calm weather like this, it's most enjoyable. I really love it. And it's wonderful. It's a good job. It's out with people, out in a good environment. We work long hours. I probably get four to six hours in sleep a night. When I get home, my gal can't understand why I just want to lay on the couch and do nothing and be a couch potato. So. It's a wonderful life. I really enjoy it. Yeah, the bait's all red and all the scales are off. It's barely moving. It's got all the red marks in it. You know, like that. It's not all lively. It's barely moving. That's not a good bait. So what you want to do is always take your time at the bait tank and get a good bait. Okay? So let's take this one off and I'll show you how to get a good bait. Your forefinger right there, you just scoop it sideways to the nose. You let go of the bait so you don't knock all the scales off. You come right to the back of the boat right over here. Let him cast out. Cast a nice, easy cast out away from the boat. This way, when the boat is drifting, it'll drift away from your bait will go away from the boat. Good luck.
Thank you, sir.
You're welcome.
Got him?
Got him. There you go. Turn around. There's a nice albacore. Thank you.
fly bait fishing, one of the most important factors for fly lining the bait or fishing with live bait is make sure that you tie a proper knot when you're fishing. Now I'm going to show you a couple of basic knots that I like to use all the time. Now one of them is called the Palomar knot. And what you do with the Palomar knot is you take your line, you fold it in half, and you slide it right to the eye of the hook. You go ahead and just tie an overhand knot, and then you take the loop and slide it over the hook. And then pinch it down. I like to wet it. And then cinch it all the way down. Now before you cinch it real hard, I like to use a pair of dykes or a rail or something and pull it hard like that. Well, you have a nice, good, firm connection there. Cut out this tag end, and that is a Palomar knot. Good knot to tie, but sometimes if you're fishing live bait, you want to have a knot that's free swinging. This is called a perfection loop. It's a real easy knot to tie, just takes a little bit of practice. Go ahead and make a loop in your line, and slide the hook on. Then you're going to go ahead and make another loop behind it, come back, and go right in between the two. Then you take that hook, you slide it through the first loop, and you just pull down, holding both lines. And you come down to a nice tight knot. This is called perfection loop. And again, you go ahead and cut off the tag end. Take your dykes, pull on the knot, make sure it doesn't come loose. And if your knot's gonna break, you want it to happen now, not when you're hooked up on the fish. And what's nice about this knot is now that hook moves freely, swings in there, and your bait looks more lifelike when he swims through the water. If you learn this knot, this is the number one knot for live bait fishing for albacore. Works really good. All right, well, let's get back and show you some more action on how to catch some albacore. two-speed reel, heavy outfit, the feather I'm trolling with is a rather large feather, about twice the size of the other guys, still the same make by Zucker. Here comes my fish right here. There he comes. There he is, right there. All right. Nice albacore. So we have a free spool right there. Hold it right there. You can see this is what we're talking about, trolling. This is a trolling feather that I'm using, made by Zucker Flathead. There's a double hook that we're showing you earlier. And the swivel, keep the line from getting tangled up. This is the net result. We get a fish, we bring the fish into the boat, and you see behind us, it turns wide open action, and this is how it all gets started.
Nice fish, Steve.
Thanks. Next to me is Rick. He's the chef here aboard the American Angler, and he'll be giving us one of his favorite recipes for cooking up some albacore.
Good evening. This is one of our recipes we use in American Angler. It consists of four basic units, half a pound of butter, about an eighth of a cup of fresh ground or crushed garlic. You have about two tablespoons of fresh or dried dill, and two cups of a blush wine, or a nice sweet white wine. What you want to do is basically saute all the ingredients together in a pan, and this is what we've come up with right here. It's not a marinade, but it's just a dipping juice. And we've got two nice fillets of albacore. What we want to do...
It's kind of like your homemade little
sauce. Yeah, we just kind of experimented a little bit, and it works very well with albacore, yellowfin tuna, and wahoo. On a barbecue, medium coals. You can bake it also, but it's much better on a barbecue. Just dip it like this.
Well, that's quick.
Yeah, your cooking time is basically 2.5 to 3 minutes on each side. And as you can see on this piece here, it's starting to turn white. These pieces are cut in approximately 1-inch pieces. And what you want to do is get them about 1/4 inch cooked through. And then once they're to that point, you got nice grill marks on them. Let's see if we can do it right now. The butter really adds a lot to adding the grill marks and also keeping the moisture in the fish. But say, for instance, that fish has been cooked through, and you go ahead and flip it. And you don't want to overcook your fish because it'll get real dry. And before you do flip it, I do suggest dipping it once again like this. And that just adds more to the flavor of the fish and also keeps the fish from sticking on the grill. When your fish is done, after about 5 minutes, just take it like this. If you like, you can garnish it with some fresh lemon, some green onion. And if you feel brave, you could use some wasabi and soy sauce just for a little added touch. And also some regular wasabi to add some spice to it. And that's what you have right there.
Boy, that looks great. And I like the way you add the onions and the lemon. It just adds a lot of color.
Certainly.
Something that's very plain.
Oh, it's excellent. Some people like it, the tuna hotter than others. Taste it the way you like it.
Well, I got to try a piece of this. Oh, I like that. Nice and medium.
See, it's not overdone. You know?
That's the biggest mistake I see with fish. People overcook it.
Overcook it. It tastes like shoe leather.
That's delicious. That is really good. Thank you very much,
Rick. Very good. Thank you.
Delicious recipe. Try this at home. But if you really want to try it right, book a trip here on the American Angler and have Rick cook it up for you. Well, let's get back on the water and show you more exciting action here aboard the American Angler and our 3-day trip. This is good. I like this.
Anybody else again?
There, he's right there. He's just taking our bait. See the line go off the reel? He's taking the line off the reel. Go ahead and give him a little bit more. Make sure he's there. Walk my way into the corner here. There he goes. He's there for sure now. He's taking all this line. So I need to point my rod at the fish, put the reel in gear. There. Oh, that's how you farm a fish.
This is how we do it right here.
Watch
the line peel off, put it in gear. And you're on.
There you go. Thanks, Larry.
Try to pull it in.
Yeah, no, that's good. gonna be like this for 2 days. Make some new friends. Well, here we go. Let's get to the end of the trip. And just another wide open blind. We got another fish right here, color, beautiful albacore. Big, big fish. Might need a gaff, guys. Nacho! Here comes John. There goes John. Another nice fish right here. All right, nice gap. It's a beautiful fish. Just typical of what we're catching here. Another big albacore. Been excellent fishing on this trip. Passengers have just had a great time. There's just been tons of fish. There's another fresh one going. Can't believe we're having one of the best bites of the trip. At the end of the day, it's a perfect way to end the trip. Color! Color gone. Someone's pulling on the other side.
This is a Havana cigar. Sure. All the way from Cuba.
This is our skipper, Bacon, Jim. That did a great job, him and his crew, helping everybody get their fish, putting us on fish. All right, Jim, here we go. All right, beautiful gap. Perfect trip. Yeah, perfect way to end it. Perfect gap right there in the head. That's great.
Great trip, Dad.
Thanks a lot, Jim. Thanks for having us. Everybody had a great time. That was pretty exciting, all that fish we caught on the American Angler. That was a great 3-day trip. Everybody got limits. It was just excellent fishing. Well, we got a little bit more to show you as we go fishing now on the Indian, again out of San Diego, down to Mexico for albacore.
There we got deep color. First one's back there.
Got him.
One bluefin. I think we got another. Dan's got a bluefin too. This one looks like albacore. Coming up the gap right now. It's like about a 12-15 pound albacore. Kind of nice fish. See how he holds the fish nice and flat so it's really consistent.
Yeah.
That's okay. Stay right up the rail where you can see your fish and lay him up. Lay him up nice and flat right there, just like that. Pull straight up. You get a nice shot that way.
Did you get a free spool?
Yeah.
There you go.
Here, come on in here, come on in here.
Here's a nice bait fish albacore caught on the anchovy. Good job.
Thank you.
Beautiful fish.
Okay,
bag him. Not quite ready to give it up.
No. You don't want to die that easy.
Here we get close, Captain. We're going to get underway here, gang.
No, Stig, it's real.
First one.
Perfect gap. There's the elbow.
Perfect gap.
First one.
Okay, we're on that game.
Excellent. Fish now fishing the anchovy. Third?
Yes.
Third. Oh, I'm sorry. He's on his third bait fish fishing the anchovy. A lot of the guys are still fishing the sardine.
The guys that are smart to switch over to the anchovy catch more fish. It does like the anchovy. It's on big bait balls out here. And you see, once again, he's using his thumb technique. If you're proficient at it, you can do it, but I don't recommend it if you're not used to doing it that way, because you have to know right when to let go. But he's doing a good job. Once again, he's keeping a really good bend in the rod, a nice arc, a steady pull. It's not a jerky action, a nice steady pull. And he's keeping constant pressure on that fish, following it wherever it goes. He's doing an excellent job. And he has three fish in the, or he will have three fish in the bag to show for it. And what is it, 7 a.m.? That's a pretty good start.
6:30.
6:30. Well, maybe you have four by 7 a.m. Then you have to break for breakfast. Now you're doing an excellent job. And see, when it does a run, you can see how he just stops pulling when it does a run and let it do its thing. That way you don't bust him off. Doing an excellent job. Should have color any minute.
The fish that we're catching right now, these average size albacore?
Yeah, these are the average schoolie size, you know, 12 to 15 pounds. There's some little 3-4 pound tikers mixed in with them, and there's some lunkers too. And there were some very large bluefin seen yesterday, up to like 110, 20 pounds. So we may run into a few of those before the day's over. It's early.
Yep.
Once again, Dan has brought us good luck. He's our good luck charm.
The whole trick is to keep everything smooth and easy.
Oh!
There he goes.
Line in. He doesn't want to dive right now.
Don't play with the drag.
Don't want to touch the drag when you're on a fish, because you can't tell how much tension you're putting on.
That's very true.
All right.
Slow down. Take a break. Slow down. Let the fish do some work for you. Just take a break slowly. Hold them. Hold them. Hold them. Don't wind down. Lower the rod real fast. Okay, now just stop. Now just take a break and come up slow.
Okay, guys,
slow down a notch. May I have this one again, please? See what the fish are doing? Yeah, this one here.
There he is.
Hold it high, hold it high, hold it high. Hold it, hold it, hold it, hold it. Hold it. One more time, man.
You got it.
Good job. Here, step in here. Bring it in here.
Oh, I've got a line.
Donna's got her first fish of the day. Was it fun?
Yeah, it was awesome. Are you kidding?
Fantastic. What's your bag number?
Number 2.
Okay.
Got him. There you go.
Sigging free
spool.
Okay.
There you go.
This is the albacore of the day.
Turbo on the
gaff.
There
you go.
This is Wayne, our angler. And for those of you that are trout fishermen and you use Zeke's floating bait,
he's the man.
This is Mr. Floating Bait himself. But your bait isn't designed to catch fish like this.
Oh, yeah. 2-pound test line, it works every time.
Oh, yeah. Did you use a floating gold on that one, or did you use anchovy?
I did a variety of rainbow.
A rainbow?
Yeah. Turbo. No, this is anchovy.
Nice albacore.
Yeah, congratulations.
Fights just like a trout.
Yeah.
You've caught these before, huh?
Oh, yeah.
This is the first one of the season, or?
The first one, we was out 3 weeks ago, and we caught a lot of them.
Okay, let's see, first one today. Mm-hmm. All right, see when he's fishing, he's got a live bait hook in there, a very small sinker.
And on weight.
Yeah, the skipper's been talking, Randall's been telling everybody to stay with the anchovies, and that's what he did. And he got his next fish.
There's the end result. Coming around. Some of you guys might want to step right up and over the fish there. Right up and over. Just go right up and over the fish there. There we go. Another schoolie albacore.
Yep.
Oh, blood bomb.
That's number 3.
Yeah, I believe you're over. Nope.
Under.
Yeah, come under. Yeah, that looks better there, I think. There we go. Yeah, that's correct. You can see how the guys are weaving their way under and over the fish. As the boat drifts stern first, they just kind of work their way through the fish so you don't get tangled. That way, if you get bit, you're not already in a tangle. And they just work their way up. When they get to the bow, they change the bait and come back. And we need to take a couple steps this way, just a couple. There you go. Remember, it's finesse and technique. It's not brute strength. You're going to out-finesse this fish. And the idea is to get that rod higher. Hold it, hold it. You're trying to, look at, his head's doing this. You need his head to do this. The only way you do that is by getting a real high arc on that rod. Keep coming up, keep coming. Just steady pull, keep going higher, higher. Get that rod up there, get it up there, get it up there. That'll turn his head. When you feel his head give, then grind down. Wind all the way down to the water. All the way down, all the way down, all the way down. There you go. See how you got five or six turns on that? Yeah. That's how you gain on him. You're gonna outsmart this fish. Keep going, hold him higher, higher, hold it, hold it. Now, go. Did you feel his head give?
Yeah.
That's it. It's technique. It's not brute strength. That's that knot that was sliding. That's the remnants of a tangle, and it should just go right through. If you want, why don't you step back real quick, and we'll take a look at it. Step straight back for me. Straight back, straight back, straight back. This is what we call, in sport fishing, macrame. Okay, we'll leave that. Just let that slide. This should slide right through. Don't worry about it. Just keep right on fishing. Come right back to the rail. Remember that big, steady high arc, not jerky, nice, steady high arc. Hold him, and you'll feel his head give. Right there, grind down. Feel the give?
Yes.
That's the technique. Especially with bluefin, it's real important with bluefin to get that rod up real high so that you can get his head to come up a little bit and wind down on him. Better than brute strength, huh?
Yeah.
That's Marcus. Another tangle here. Marcus, come up here and step back. We'll get
there. Nice albacore. A little bit higher there.
There we go. Another nice schoolie size. Here, turn around for the camera. Another nice schoolie size albacore. First one?
No, first one's for the year, but.
That's the first one.
Oh, okay.
You gotta get one in the bag.
One in the sack.
That's it. This is our second captain, Marcus, catching a fish before he goes to bed, which will be shortly.
Very shortly.
Remember, it's a leveraging. It's not brute strength there. It's finesse. Okay? Keep it high, higher. Hold him, hold him, hold him, hold him. Get his head to come up. Wait for his head to come up. Hold him. Now, grind all the way down. Now, come on, real slow. Slow, slow, slow.
Let him move quick.
Grind down, grind down. Nice and slow. You got him. He's coming up. Go after him. Go after him. Take him. See how you had his head up there for a few seconds? He came up. Keep on him. He's going to give. Higher, higher, higher. Grind down. Take it. Nice and slow on the pull up. Doing a good job. You're almost there. Wind down. Wind down. Wind down. What's your name, partner?
Tofu.
Tofu. Not to be confused with tofu. All right. Let me get a gap.
There he goes.
Pull this one that way, Turbo. Go over the top of us, quickly. Go over the top of us, quickly, 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 quickly. You're almost home free here. Keep pulling up nice and slow. Watch, go up and over, please. Oh, there you go. You're almost home free. It's an albacore.
Oh.
You're getting killed on an albacore. Watch your line here. You get too much angle. You need to be up this way. Go over it. You go over it. You can have the world's meanest albacore. You're right here. Pull up. One more turn.
Here we go. One more turn.
Oh, nice one. Look at this. Here, turn around for the camera. Turn around for the camera. He got his butt kicked. Is it tofu?
Yeah, tofu.
Tofu got his butt kicked. We thought it was a bluefin, but it's a nice albacore. Are you tired?
I'm going in for breakfast. I'm done.
Nice fish.
Thank you.
Probably a 25, 30 pounder easy.
Woo!
That's more like it, huh? You did a good job, man. You really did. This is our up and down meter. It's looking directly below the boat. And you can set it at whatever range you want. You can set it at 40 fathoms, 50 fathoms, whatever you'd like to. Right now we're running at 20 because most of the fish seem to be within 20 fathoms. Each fathom is 6 feet. So right now we got the meter set at 120 feet and it's got gain adjustments and everything. And when you get a fish school on the sonar, which is this screen over here, I don't know if you can see it, this is sweeping out in front of us. It's looking out 239 feet. 78 feet is the depth. It's like a cone that sweeps out in front of it, just like a submarine sonar. And when you get a fish mark, it'll be a series of red hacks and stuff. And it takes a little time to discern the marks from those. And I don't know if you can hear the clicking noise, but this is the noise it makes. And when you get a fish, it'll go from a click to a pop or a clack. so you don't have to actually stare right at the meter. And basically that's what I'm doing right now, scanning the horizon, looking for jumpers, listening to the radios, and watching the sonar, spinning on stuff and getting on up and down. We also watch our temperature gauge here. There's somebody just had 25 bluefin. And right now we're fishing 64.2 degrees water, and we're looking for our next school. And things are looking up.
Just stay right there, he's just gonna circle.
Little football-sized albacore. What's your bag number, Mike?
Heavy tackle, the big pin. Big pin reel.
Big boy.
That's it.
The trollfish?
Yep, it's a trollfish.
Big albacore.
That's a nice fish. One more circle.
Good quality. Keep the head in the water.
There we go. Let's do the old tail hook for him. Oh, this is a heavy one. It's a nice
quality
one.
Fish.
And, yeah. Yep. This color jig right here, folks, if you can see it, it's the. What do they call it, Dan?
Zucchini?
It's a snooker.
A snooker?
Made by Zucker Lures.
Yeah. Find me the color pattern.
Yeah, that's called a zucchini color.
Yeah, that's a zucchini. That's been working real well.
Stick it! Ah!
Save one, it came on butt. Yeah,
it was. All right, guys,
came off the hook
and
still
here.
Got it.
Right
on.
You need to get around the corner.
You're
way around the corner.
Yeah. Boil on the corner. Boil on the corner, guys. Get a bait out.
Come on, guys. Use the
anchovy. What's bag number?
15.
Gap in the bow. This was a free gapper. It actually came off the hook, and the deckhand dove down and pulled it out and saved it. Good
what
job.
A
what a deal, huh?
There's a friend. Larry's on. Get him, Larry.
Thank you.
Oh, that's a nice one. Here, turn around for the camera. Nice albacore. David Justin.
Nice albacore. He weighs about 15 to 18 pounds.
Nice one. These are nicer fish. These are 25, 30 pound albies. Oh, yeah. Nice albies. Look, he's wagging his tail. He's happy to see you. Nice albie.
All right.
Those are nice fish. Oh, yeah. Got a little size to them there. Anybody else got color yet? You guys okay?
Yep. Oh, my God.
Hey, what a stick. All right. Nope. Here we go. Ta-da! Nice albacore. Okay, I gotta go. I got a gap. This is what we're looking for, guys. This is a bluefin. There we go. Nicer fish. Come on over here. This is what we're looking for. This is about a 35-pound bluefin tuna. You can tell the difference because the pectoral fins are a lot shorter and it has a little bit different color. Very nice fish. This is the sought-after species. See the stripes in the belly, the lighter color, whereas albacore has a very long fin that if you fold it over backwards will actually cover the eye. Nice bluefin. We got him.
Did you get him?
We got
him.
Yeah.
Stink off on the other side.
Short pump.
Right now.
There you go, just short pump, nice and slow. Short pump.
Now, take it.
Very good.
No,
it should turn around and come right back.
Yeah, it's coming back, it's coming back.
Let's just concentrate on this fish here. This is the toughest part of the battle right here. The fish sees a boat, he knows that he's in trouble and he's gonna do everything he can to keep his head down. Even though the fish is tired, it's gonna nose down on you.
Minus five.
Here it comes.
Yeah!
Woo!
You
get a blue bait?
Yeah!
Okay, stand back here with your fish.
Good job, Eileen.
Yeah. Nice bluefin there. Nice bluefin. Very nice.
Good job.
Okay.
Thanks for your help, you guys.
Haul it that way, Justin. Haul it that way. Will you go with Justin just so we can get the rest of these guys in here?
Thanks. I got you.
But that's all right.
Well, they're still the right kind.
Tuna, that's all that matters.
See how fast it came out of that tackle setup, though? With the two-speed, it comes in so quick. Just straight to the boat.
Makes
fast
it easy.
Efficient. Oh, yeah.
That fish normally would have taken me 2 or 3 times as long.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
All right, quality fish.
Right tackle for the right job.
See this fish? Well, I just named him.
What is it?
Dinner.
Dinner?
Dinner.
With a capital D.
Dinner with a little sushi. All right, watch these guys here. They're all bit. We got fish coming back here. More fish.
Here,
Randall.
An albacore. Well, we got one good shot of
them. Yes. All right, nice hit, Gaff. Way to go, Turbo.
You want to hold it up or do you want to hold it up?
Get right here, Lawrence.
Slide on in there.
This is Lawrence Johnson. This is Turbo. This is our captain, Chris Randall, over here. This is another quality fish.
And we're
a long ways from home, so we're going to be heading home right after this. But another quality fish here, Lawrence.
We got a little over 60 albacore and a few bluefin. Not a bad day. It's been slow fishing, and it's just on the upswing here. And you can see these are real nice quality albacore.
This is Dan Hernandez, hoping you enjoyed this how-to video on how to catch albacore. We had a lot of fun bringing it to you, and I'd like to thank the crews of the American Angler and the Indian for helping us so much in making this production possible. Just a reminder that Dan Hernandez Productions has a wide series of how-to videos. Look for them at fishing tackle shops near you, or visit us on the web at sport-fishing.com and look under our online store for a wide selection of our how-to tapes and books. Well, thanks again for watching this video, and we'll see you on the water next week.